KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, 88.1 in Fresno, and K248BR Santa Cruz. 2 o'clock, time now for About Health with Nurse Rona.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. Somewhere between 30 to 50 million Americans are affected by autoimmune diseases such as Graves, type 1 diabetes, ulcerative colitis, rheumatoid arthritis, and multiple sclerosis. And there are more than 80 different types of autoimmune diseases. It's not clear why a person's immune system begins to malfunction, but some suspected factors are environmental pollutants, chemical toxins, bacteria or viral infections, and maybe even side effects from certain drugs. I'm Nurse Rona. I'm here twice a month to explore different concepts of health and well-being. Today's topic is a big one, and one that I've been interested in for a long time. You know, most conventional doctors treat the symptoms of autoimmune diseases, but often don't look to find the root causes. So I've invited Dr. Harry McIlroy to join us today to help us understand more about this very complex topic. Harry McIlroy is an integrative physician certified with the Institute for Functional Medicine, and before medical school and completion of residency at Contra Costa Regional Medical Center, Harry had a background in nutrition and obtained a master's in acupuncture and Chinese medicine. Harry strives to provide patients with health tools that empower them to improve their well-being. Dr. Harry McIlroy, welcome back to About Health.
Hi, Rona. It's great to be back.
Really, really good to have you in studio today. So let's get right into it and start off by reviewing some really basic things about the immune system. We know that when it functions normally, it protects us against harmful substances. But I want you to address what happens when it goes out of whack and targets its own cells or organs.
Sure, Rona. Yeah, like you spoke to in the beginning, I mean, the immune system is something that we need to live and survive. Without it, we are exposed to a multitude of bacteria and viruses, and those viruses would then, without an immune system intact, would kill us. And so part of the issue with autoimmunity is not whether or not our immune system is functioning, but is it functioning appropriately? And one of the things that happens with autoimmunity is that the body is seeing these pathogens and bacteria as non-self and attacking them, and that's something that should normally be happening. What's happening with a lot of these processes is they are in a feedback loop, and the body, instead of getting rid of the virus or bacteria and then moving on, is constantly in this cycle of inflammation and attack. And when that it goes on unabated, we start to have a lot of problems.
So it's, say the virus is gone, or the bacteria is gone, and the inflammation continues, that's when it could start to target our own cells.
Yeah, like for instance, you know, we're still needing to do a lot of research on this, but for example, rheumatoid arthritis, which is one of the more common autoimmune processes, there's a lot of research going on right now looking at Klebsiella, which is a bacteria that is we call commensal a lot of the times. It's something that's found in our digestive tract and normally doesn't cause any problems, but when it becomes pathogenic and gets into our bloodstream, it starts this cascade of inflammation and attack, and that's what is often found with rheumatoid arthritis. And so the question there is, well, here's something that's been around forever, like Klebsiella, why are we having such an increase in the autoimmune diseases? And a lot of that comes from, well, what's changed in our diet and lifestyle and environment that could have caused an increase in our susceptibility to these autoimmune diseases?
So that's what we want to talk about today for sure, is what's changed, what's shifted. We want to talk a little bit about diagnosis, and we also want to talk about treatment.
Sure. So some of the things that have shifted, I'm going to go through just a couple different examples, and there are many, but one of the primary things, and certainly when we talk about dietary ways that we can address autoimmunity, is this concept of leaky gut. And leaky gut really is when we have an intact immune system and GI tract, gastrointestinal tract. There are things that are we go through our mouth, and they process through our digestive system, and our body takes what it needs. It takes the macronutrients, the vitamins, the minerals, and then utilizes those to make us healthy and whole. What happens when we start to have more inflammation from in our gastrointestinal tract, then we have more of these microbes, these foreign pathogens that were really supposed to stay in our digestive tract and get removed through going to the bathroom. They are then getting into our bloodstream, and our body then is seeing them as non-self and attacking them.
So people often ask, with this a fairly new concept, leaky gut. I mean, it's been around, but I know it's only the last few years that I've heard about it. It's almost as though with inflammation and with dietary poor choices sometimes, mm-hmm. There's actually the lining of the intestines gets, what would you say, irritated, open a little.
Yeah, or even thinned out.
Thinned out.
That's one of the issues with stress. Stress is something that we absolutely need. Acute stress, a lion comes in our view, starts chasing after us. We need to be able to get out of there. What happens when that acute stress continues unabated and it becomes chronic stress is that we're always in this state of fight or flight, which is really deleterious to our health and well-being. And one of the things with that is that the lining of the gastrointestinal tract, which is our first barrier really to these foreign pathogens that we have consumed on food that hasn't been washed correctly or a number of other ways, that barrier, if it becomes too thin, then that allows those pathogens to enter into our bloodstream, basically go from outside of ourselves, the gastrointestinal tract, into our bloodstream.
Which sets our immune system into a bit of a tizzy.
It causes this chronic inflammation. The chronic stress leads to chronic inflammation. And I like to think of that as this almost sense of unknowing. When we're constantly on guard, we become hyper-reactive. And that's one of the things that happens with our immune system. It becomes hyper-reactive.
So many questions keep popping in my mind, sure. But I want to invite our listeners as well to call. So you can call us with your questions and experiences with autoimmune diseases. We'll open up the phone lines in just a minute here. Call us at 1-800-958-9008. That's 1-800-958-9008, and that's toll free. So these 80 or more diseases, we are under umbrella called autoimmune disease. Mm-hmm. And it's because they all, we think, have a reaction, as you're describing now, that the immune system is somehow out of whack.
Correct.
And so, for instance, you know, I have autoimmune disease. I've mm-hmm. talked about it on the air. I have Hashimoto's and
yes.
thyroid disease. I had Graves' disease. So that gets treated by a traditional doctor by making sure I have enough thyroid hormone. But what's not being looked at is some of the underlying causes of that. And that's what I'm just starting to learn about over these last few years, is it's not enough just to look at, say, diabetes. Type 1 is also an autoimmune disease. Mm-hmm. We're not just looking at how much insulin a person should get, but we have to look at other ways to understand this disease process.
Yeah, and so that speaks to causality. And I think one of the more confounding parts of autoimmunity is that within the conventional medical system, it really doesn't lie under one umbrella. So, for instance, if you have rheumatoid arthritis, you're going to see a rheumatologist. If you have Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, you're going to see a gastroenterologist. Thyroid disease or type 1 diabetes, you're going to see an endocrinologist. And they give great treatment, and there isn't necessarily anything inherently wrong with that, but it's very much treating the process once it's started. And there is no residency in autoimmunity. It really even something like oncology, which is incredibly complex with so many different types of cancers, that they're still, you're going to go and see an oncologist and maybe see other practitioners as well, but there's still someone who primarily has that degree of training. And that's the issue, or one of the issues with why I think autoimmunity is so confounding and goes undiagnosed for so long, because there isn't like a portal that can direct patients, you know, directly to the care that they need.
Well, you know, I was reading recent surveys conducted by the American Autoimmune Related Diseases Association revealed that 45% of patients with autoimmune diseases have been labeled hypochondriacs, especially in the earliest stage of their illnesses. And they said that it also had to do with the fact that 75 to 80% of autoimmune disease sufferers were women, who are more easily dismissed by the medical establishment when hard to diagnose symptoms arise. So sometimes it takes as long as 5 years for a person to actually from the time they start having symptoms to being diagnosed and treated. Harry, let's take some calls.
Sure.
We have a call now from Lisa in Oakland. You're on About Health, Lisa.
Hey, thanks for doing the show. I was diagnosed many years ago with chronic fatigue, Epstein-Barr.
Mm-hmm.
However, I wasn't treated till a couple years ago. Stanford now has a chronic fatigue center, which is actually still very traditional. And at the same time with IBS, I was just reading an article in the National Institutes of Health on the connection between IBS and chronic fatigue.
And I want to say IBS is irritable bowel syndrome, for those people who don't know.
Right. But, you know, as you were mentioning, because of the fragmented nature of medicine, it became really difficult, because part of the problem with chronic fatigue, you have sleep problems. So I went to the Stanford Sleep Clinic for 15 years. They kept trying to diagnose this as relating to sleep apnea. So I just want to encourage patients who are having difficulty finding someone who can pull this all together, not to feel crazy, that there are, that you are not crazy, that you are falling into the gaps in the limitation of medicine, that can't see the connections between all your different symptoms and are still figuring this out. I mean, it was only, 10 years ago that they even figured out that there was back.
Oh. Hmm. I lost Lisa. Oh, there you are. Sorry, I thought I lost you there for a minute. Thank you for saying that, Lisa. Really, really important for people to understand how difficult the treatment is. Harry?
Yeah, Lisa, thanks for your call and especially the content of what you were saying and the frustration behind that. Again, part of this issue comes to the fact that doctors are trained exquisitely well and for a long period of time. And as they move up that specialization ladder, they become very well-versed at being able to diagnose, disease patterns that fall within the specificity of their training. And one of the issues with autoimmunity, because it has so many different causes, is that if people are presenting with kind of a vague constellation of symptoms that doesn't fall right into, you know, the protocol that we're trained in residency, then oftentimes it is that. It is, oh, this person's, you know, a hypochondriac, or they're not, there's really nothing wrong with them, and we don't have anything specific. There's not a specific lab test, especially for something like chronic fatigue. And it really creates a problem for our medical system, which just really isn't oriented around treating these types of diseases.
You know, Lisa,
can you talk about IBS and CFS? Because this article does a nice investigation into how the microbial aspect of your gut can affect your autoimmune system, and how people with CFS often have IBS. It's not clear which comes first, which the cofactors are. Maybe they're just mutually interdependent.
Great question.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, and Lisa, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Dr. McIlroy address the gut and the microbial connection, and then I'm going to probably say goodbye to you and take another call, because there are a lot of people calling in.
Sure.
But I just really appreciate you getting to us right away. So the gut connection.
Sure. Yeah, and Lisa, so part of that, and I'm going to actually talk about the Epstein-Barr prior to that, just along with that, in the sense that there has been a correlation with chronic fatigue and the Epstein-Barr virus. And so quite possibly, you know, even some of our lifestyle, changes that have happened in the last 30 or 40 years, I mean, these viruses that have been around before then, and it's not like autoimmune just started happening, these processes 50 or 60 years ago, but the virus can be something that kicks it off. And then if your microbiome or your gut health is not properly balanced, then that can can cause the pathology to really run away. And so that's why it's so important to make sure that we're eating good quality, clean food, that we're getting sufficient probiotics and prebiotics, and really tending to, I like to think of this as tending to the garden in our gastrointestinal system. It really is, we need to be constantly adding soil amendments and farming and giving it care. And when that gets out of whack through processed foods, through stress, as we talked about previously, all these things, it makes that whole inflammatory and autoimmune process just really escalate.
You know, I think when people are listening to the idea of, about prebiotics, probiotics, clean food, we just have to spend another minute here saying a little bit more about that. You know, prebiotics are the vegetables you eat, the food you eat that, and if you look it up, you can Google prebiotic and you can find out what they are. But in general,
garlic, onions, I mean, certainly vegetables in general, but
asparagus.
Some of the, chicory, which isn't something that we commonly eat, but it has something called inulin in it, which is one of the most pervasive prebiotics, and it's found in a lot of different vegetables, Jerusalem artichokes and a lot of other root vegetables.
And then the probiotics that you can take, and if you get a really good one in a capsule, you have to look for good ones, not the cheapest version, but also it's sauerkraut and kimchi and yogurt that has lactobacillus. And
yeah, always starting with fermented foods. Every traditional, I mean, I think one of the reasons why this has gone so awry in the U.S., and we absolutely have more diagnoses and prevalence of autoimmune disease than any other country that I'm aware of, and one of the reasons for that is that the standard American diet has no room or no concept of fermented foods and probiotics in general, whereas when you look at, you know, in Germany, there's sauerkraut. In India, there are the pickles. In China, there are the kimchis. I mean, all these things in Korea, all these parts of foods that they have naturally been in the traditional dietary system have been working to, you know, really feed and tend the microbiome.
Yes. So we'll continue talking about this. Lisa, I hope you continue to listen. Let's take another call. We have Greg from Palo Alto with us. Greg, you're on About Health.
Hello. Thanks for your program. I know that you mentioned this early on and have followed up with other issues, bringing in stress. And if stress isn't a major factor in causing the original problem or challenge that anybody would have, I guarantee you that if somebody develops one of these problems, they're going to have intense stress dealing with this problem.
Yes.
But here's the issue. If you go to a doctor, generally in conventional medicine, sometimes even in complementary alternative medicine, what they'll do is they'll give you maybe a diagnosis if you're lucky enough to get one. And then they might prescribe medications for you. If you're lucky, they might say, hey, listen, you might want to get in this stress reduction program. But on the whole, I think even though stress is on the lips of most of the doctors that I deal with, they do not have a good follow-up plan for people
absolutely.
Who have problems.
That's right.
To deal with the stress.
That's right. You're absolutely right. You know, people say, oh, just reduce your stress. Right. That makes me more stressed. I do want to say right off the bat, that the mindfulness-based stress reduction programs, mm-hmm. the 9-week classes that I know Kaiser offers, many people offer based on Jon Kabat-Zinn's work, really does help with stress. But you're right, just going and getting a diagnosis increases your stress. And also, we know that a lot of doctors have this pressure of talking to someone in 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not a lot of follow-up, as Greg says.
Yeah, Greg, thanks for the call, and I appreciate that sentiment. And you're absolutely right. If it wasn't there beforehand, then it will be there after. Like Rona had spoken to as far as the mindful-based stress reduction, that's a wonderful program that is becoming more and more accessible at Kaiser. And then there are also books and online communities where people are able to get that going. I really encountered this a lot early on in practice because, you know, at the end of the visit, oh, and make sure, do you have a meditation practice? Make sure you have one. Well, it is very easy to say have a meditation practice. It's very easy, very difficult to take someone who's never had any mindfulness training and sit still and listen to the cacophony of their thoughts and their monkey mind going wild. And so one of the things that I started utilizing that sounds simple, I actually have had a lot of success with it. And there are a number of really good apps for smartphones that work really well that also have some online components too. But one of them is called Headspace and the other one is called Calm, both of which have free trials. And Headspace is a gentleman named Andy with a British accent. And if that appeals to you, great. And if not, the Calm is a female voice. And it really holds people accountable and also gives them a program. And I really recommend, you know, a minimum of 10 minutes a day for 30 days, because like anything, this is a habit. You don't go out and start playing racquetball and be good at racquetball in a week. You really have to practice. And that's the same thing with mindfulness and meditation. It really needs to be something that you cultivate.
I use the one called Insight Timer. It's free, and it tells you who else is meditating with you at the same time. It's a nice one as well when I remember to use it.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I mean, we're talking a little bit here about treatment already, but I think when we are under stress, basically taking many slow belly breaths and calming ourselves is the beginning step of changing the cortisol in our brain. If you want to say something about that.
That comes back to very much that chronic stress, that idea of chronic stress. And when we're in this chronic state of sympathetic overdrive, the fight or flight, we really need to be able to downregulate that and really work on our parasympathetic or our rest and digest nervous system. And one of the things that can really do that we have conscious control over is breath. And so Andrew Weil was one of the first people that taught me this a long time ago, and there's something, this simple 4-7-8 breath. You inhale for a count of 4 through your nose, you hold it for a count of 7, and then you exhale for a count of 8 through your mouth. If you do that 10 times and you're getting your breath down in your belly, it's really hard to maintain a high level of stress. And so doing that every morning and every evening before we go to bed kind of sets a baseline or a tone for the day.
Or when you're stuck in traffic.
And then when you're stuck in traffic, or if you're going into a meeting or you have to give a presentation or a talk or something like that, and you know you're going to be stressed, do that beforehand for the 10 breaths, and it really is effective and works.
So the broad umbrella autoimmune diseases, what we've already been saying is, yes, you have to go to a physician, whether it's a functional medicine doctor or a more traditional physician, to get diagnosed, to look at what's going on, to have the lab work. You know,
absolutely.
We're absolutely saying that's necessary, and sometimes medication is necessary for many of these disorders and diseases. But there's healthy gut eating, there's mindfulness, there's stress reduction. So we'll keep talking about some of the other treatments, but let me take another call now. We have Greg with us from Palo Alto. You're on About Health, Greg. Oh, I'm sorry. We had you, Greg. You're done, Greg.
I had a follow-up.
Oh,
good timing.
Oh, shucks. I was going to the next person, but you're still there. Okay, Greg, real quick.
Okay, real quick. It's this. I believe in mindfulness. I think it can be helpful. I don't think it's a cure-all for everybody's problems.
That's right.
That's one thing. But the other thing is, you know, people put the onus on the individual to try and cope with whatever they're dealing with. And what's absent in this, and you never hear a doctor talk about this, except for maybe somebody like Basil van der Kolk, who does trauma stuff, and that is the psychosocial system that we're living in puts people under significant levels of stress, which I think really creates serious health problems for a lot of people.
Well, I'm glad I went back to you, Greg, because that's such a key piece that you're just saying, Harry.
Yeah, just to follow up, I do think that that is absolutely contributing to, you know, just even if it is subclinical and we're just stressed all the time, we don't have physical manifestations, what this is doing to our psyche, you know, personally and as a nation is irrefutable. And I do agree that the mindfulness or the meditation doesn't cure anything, but it surely lays a foundation for health and wellness that I think because of those reasons of all the psychological trauma that we're experiencing, that we really, it's almost our first line of defense and something that we have control over and our ability to cultivate.
Yeah, and what Greg brings up, too, is that I think we're going to keep seeing an exacerbation of a lot of these autoimmune diseases as people continue to, you know, not have enough money, lose their housing, be frightened by nuclear war, and, you know, also have deregulations of environmental toxins that we're going to see. I mean, I think that's a big piece of the autoimmune diseases. So, okay, let's go to Vivian now in Berkeley. You're on About Health, Vivian.
Hi. I appreciate all the things you're talking about, but I concerned that the role of genetically modified foods is never talked about here. And I'd like to recommend a film. I don't know if you can still find it online, but it used to be you could. It's called Scientists Under Attack, not Science Under Attack, Scientists Under Attack. And it was by Jeffrey Smith, who was very concerned. He made this film, and they had chronicled a researcher in Scotland who discovered he was testing GMO foods versus non-GMO foods on rats, and he found that the rats developed destroyed the intestines of rats. And he gave a speech on it the day after he was fired.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also talked about this guy Chappella, who is at Berkeley, they've tried to fire him numerous times. He's discovered that GMO corn that the pollen, you know, has polluted so much corn. Anyway, I just am. Monsanto, you know, has so much power. And also another thing is that vaccines have been found to have glyphosate, which is Roundup, and also GMO foods have Roundup they pile that on when they. Anyway, I just
thank you for bringing this up.
Isn't talked about more, and I would appreciate if doctors would start thinking in those terms. You know that these things somehow Monsanto has won the argument. We have not won, the initiative in California, and it's so hard to get anything said about this, but it's the truth anyway.
Well, thank you for, you know, that's why I love the callers, and, you know, you bringing it up is important. I want to ask Dr. Harry McIlroy to address both talking about gluten and GM foods, and I want to tell my wonderful board operator here, Michael, that I turned assistant producer off by accident, so come help me if you can. Okay, Harry.
Hi, Vivian. Yeah, thank you so much for bringing that up and for the call, and it brings up got it. Okay, and it brings up a couple of good topics, and one of them is the whole, you know, genetically modified versus organic. And one of the things that I think has always been lost in that conversation, or two of the things, is that first of all, a lot of the GMO foods, while the actual genetics of the plant, that alteration, the jury can be still out as far as how deleterious that is to us. One of the things that they do to make them more resistant to the bugs is they actually increase some of the natural insecticides and pesticides they have in them, one of which is something called lectin. And lectin is something that's found found in wheat grains and a lot of legumes. And what they do with the genetic alteration is they increase that lectin. So what happens when we eat those is we're actually creating more of that inflammation. The other thing that happens, and I think that's never talked about, and hopefully with the rise in environmental medicine we'll discuss this more, is the fact that to grow these genetically modified crops, we're using a lot more pesticides, and that's where the glyphosate or the Roundup also comes in. And so not only are we exposing ourselves to more chemicals, we're also, you know, absolutely destroying the topsoil and doing very bad things to the environment. And I think that often doesn't come into the part of health, but if we don't include what changes that are happening to our climate and our local environment as part of our health, and we're missing a key piece of health and wellness.
Thank you for that. And, you know, when I went to see a functional medicine doctor, they took me off of, you know, a mm-hmm. lot of things in order to really figure out what was going on. And certainly corn was one of them, because the corn, it's hard to find
all,
corn.
Almost all of it.
Right.
Blue.
And maybe you could say something about gluten as well.
Sure. So one of the things that's happening, you know, with gluten, and it's complex. I mean, we have a couple different things. We have celiac disease, which is, you know, about 1% of the population actually has that process. Then there's also the process of gluten sensitivity. Okay. that is also very difficult to test for. But what I have found that just having people take a 30-day reprieve from all gluten products and see how they feel, and that really gives you an idea of whether or not you have that sensitivity. One of the issues specifically though with gluten and autoimmunity is something called molecular mimicry, and what happens with that is as these tight junctions and inflammation that we were talking about earlier occur, and you have more of the gluten protein coming into the bloodstream, and then the immune system basically developing awareness that this is there and it's non-self and begins to attack that. One of the problems with the molecular mimicry is the gluten protein looks like a lot of other tissues in our body, specifically the thyroid tissue. And so then every time we eat that gluten, we're causing an inflammatory reaction that not only attacks the gluten, but it also attacks, for instance, the thyroid tissue. And that's why one of the first things to do, and we've spoken to this before, one of the first things to do with the diagnosis of autoimmune thyroid disease, Hashimoto's, is to stop eating gluten.
Oh, a lot to take in here. We're talking about autoimmune diseases and the inflammation that we can get in our body from all kinds of causes. The lines are open, 1-800-958-9008. And my guest here is Dr. Harry McIlroy, and he is he's studied acupuncture, he's studied Chinese medicine, he's studied as an MD, and what else, Harry? Functional medicine doctor, and lots of other things. So let's take another call. We have Mary Louise from Palo Alto with us.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the program. Yes, well, I had sort of a mystery situation. About 3 weeks ago, my face swelled up, half of it, not really the other side, although my nose also became much enlarged, red as could be, and but the redness was not over on my left side of the face, and I had itchiness and very, very much heat that I would feel in my face. The second day I experienced it, I actually went to urgent care in Palo Alto, and they put me on antibiotic intravenous. And then they said they wanted me to come back for 6 days to get the drip. I think about the third day I mentioned to a physician who was looking at me, is it possible that this could be shingles? But I didn't have any of those blisters and things that people generally have. I just had the skin was almost like if I had put orange peel over my cheek.
Wow.
And down my face.
That must have been scary.
Yeah, it wasn't the normal skin at all. Anyway, so I got this treatment with the antibiotic. On the third day, I believe, I said that to her, could it be shingles? And she said, no, I don't think so. Then she went away for about 45 minutes, and then she came back and she said, well, maybe it is shingles. And so then they put me on an antiviral concoction together with the antibiotic. So anyway.
Are you better now?
Well, that's where I would like to get to.
That's where you would like to get to. So are you getting better?
Oh, yes, I definitely am. My nose has taken its formal size.
Yeah. Mary Louise, as you know, we can't diagnose over the radio, but this is very interesting. And why don't I see if Dr. McIlroy has any thoughts about it? It sounds like that's what you're asking.
Yeah, I had an awful lot of tests,
yeah,
you know, while this was going on, and nobody's been able to figure out what it is.
So. Uh-huh. Okay, Harry.
Okay.
Sure. On the spot. Hi, Mary Louise. Thanks for calling. You know, it actually, just from your description, and again, very difficult to be able to be more specific without a longer conversation and being able to see you and examine you. But it actually sounds a little bit more like the shingles to me, which is from the varicella virus, which can be reactivated in our life. And one of the things that when we're talking about autoimmunity is how it relates to stress. And certainly one of the things that can bring that back up is stress. And then even if you just have it once, and I know it can be a really horrible experience, it actually can last for quite a while. There's something called postherpetic neuralgia. And even once that abates through antivirals, acupuncture actually can really help with a lot of the symptoms that present. But we also have great immunizations for this that I would encourage you, even if you've had it, to go and get, because you can still get it again. And the vaccination really helps to decrease some of the symptoms that come along with it. But I'm glad you're feeling better. And I think the antiviral is probably what's doing most of the work.
Yeah. And I think acupuncture, again, what it does for me often when something's going on is it just supports my immune system so that my own body can also help heal what's going on. So we wish you well, Mary Louise. And
thank you.
Yes, thank you so much for calling. Let's take another call. We have Leslie with us from Oakland. You're on About Health, Leslie.
Hello.
Hello.
I have a question.
Yes.
How come more women get the autoimmune diseases? 9 out of 10. I have fibromyalgia, but I think I have this thing called big cell. I don't know. I've been trying to figure out what's wrong with me, but I always hear about, you know, all the, you know, women being the, I'd like to know why.
Great question. Very good question, Leslie.
Big question.
Yeah.
That is a very good question without a very great answer. I mean, it's unclear. And part of it also with that, Leslie, is that there are so many different types of autoimmunity. Absolutely. The thyroid, women are more likely to get Hashimoto's by a great degree than men. I think part of that could just be the complexity of the female body and the female hormone system. Effectively, there are so many more fluctuations that are occurring in women, you know, on a daily, certainly a monthly basis, that sometimes those fluctuations combined with other triggers of environmental or stress can really open us up to a greater likelihood that autoimmunity can occur. But it really, it's hard to address that globally, because each different, you know, disease process can have, you know, their women have more of some and equal amounts of the other. Honestly, though, I don't have a great answer, because I'm not sure we know.
Yeah, and everything I read, there didn't seem to be much understanding. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, it's interesting to see different diseases that men are more likely to get and women are more
sure.
likely to get, and what that's about, whether it is hormonally, whether there's something societal. You know, as you're asking this question, Leslie, I'm thinking about women tend to take on a lot from other
Absolutely.
People, tend to be more of caretakers. I don't know how that leaves us folks more vulnerable, if it does. But if I ever figure it out, I'll be sure and have a show about it, okay?
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks for your call. Let's talk with Cheryl now in Lafayette. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thank you so much for this show. I just happened to tune into it. And I'm really, the bottom line of my question is going to be, if one suspects a autoimmune condition, with something that's being treated as GI, how to approach it.
Yeah.
And I have a 29-year-old son in the Medi-Cal system who's been diagnosed with SIBO, which I'd never heard of before, and been treated twice with XLA and some kind of antibiotic.
Can you just say what SIBO is?
It's SIBO, and it's small intestinal bacterial overgrowth.
Okay, go ahead now. Continue,
right,
Cheryl.
You'd been talking about those microbial connections,
yes.
And it got me thinking. He has extreme fatigue, spells of extreme disorientation, a few hospitalizations, sleeps on the floor. He's vegan, only organic, non-GMO diet, low blood pressure, sometimes a little anemic, and with kind of mysterious patches of red on his hands and face sometimes. And all of a sudden, listening to your show, I was thinking, wow, maybe there's an autoimmune connection here.
Yes.
And if so, particularly in a low-level medical system,
mm-hmm.
how would one approach looking at that? Or I know it's a hard thing anyway, but I thought I would ask.
That's really important. What a great question, because, you know, we do have to play detective work for ourselves and with other people. Harry, where do you start?
Sure. Hi, Cheryl. Thanks again for the call. You know, the where you start one, two, and three is the gut. And that really is, when we were talking earlier about how the whole autoimmune cascade begins, it really begins with that leaky gut and those loose tight junctions specifically, and how we can address that. And so one of the, and what I'm going to talk about right now really is essentially focused around food, not even requiring direct supplementation. And there's a quick little program I'll talk about as far as healing the gut. The first thing that you want to do is remove anything that could be an offending agent. And that's when we talk about the wheat and the gluten and essentially grains. And you need to do that for really a minimum of 30 days to see if there's an improvement. Dairy is also another common afflictor. And so, globally, having somebody stop the gluten and the dairy, which we call a modified elimination diet, would be the first thing to start. The second thing is you want to restore that digestive fire, we say in Chinese medicine, and that can be done through digestive enzymes specifically. Then we want to re-inoculate the digestive system, and we do that with pre and probiotics that we spoke to earlier, which again can absolutely be food-based. And then we really want to work on repairing that damaged lining. And, you know, one of the big things with that is omega-3 fatty acids can help to do that, and then absolutely glutamine, which is an amino acid that is found in bone broth. That's one of the within the whole paleo nutrition world, that's one of the mainstays, and it really is taking something into our body that can really directly repair our gut lining.
And then looking at the different areas that, you know, saying there's some anemia, there's some spots, you also, it would be ideal if he could work with a functional medicine person in order to move forward. There are places, I mean, Cheryl's in Lafayette. Is your son in Lafayette as well, Cheryl?
No, he's east. In a more rural area.
I see.
But he is vegan, and he has been on, they want him a year on that Mediterranean diet, which is what you're describing, the no wheat, no gluten,
sure.
No dairy, and he is vegan. And he does do the probiotics, and it's very interesting how, you know, it just made me think the mystery of autoimmune.
Yes.
And how this could be tied into his conditioning. But he doesn't seem to be getting really better.
And that's difficult. Yeah, Cheryl, that's difficult, and also I understand the complexity of this. It's important to get allies, whether that is, you know, allies that we can get in books, certainly from friends and family, and then also hopefully finding appropriate medical professionals that can help guide through that system. Regarding the low fee, there are more and more umbrella organizations that are providing some more complementary and alternative medicine. There's an organization called Integrative Medicine for the Underserved, I am the number four us.org.
Let's say that again. I am the number four us.org.
Exactly. And they are a great organization that actually, if you go to that website, they have a lot of free resources and can really help point people in the right direction.
Yeah. And I find that more and more now, once you get this aha, like maybe there's an autoimmune piece here, again, there's a lot of information out there, and it takes a while to sort through it because, you know, we have to know who our source is also.
Absolutely.
And so that's why some of Andrew Weil's stuff, I am for us.org. Anything else that comes to your mind right now?
Well, again, just reiterating having the faith and promise in food, and it sounds like your son's, you know, on the right track. But really, one of the things that I have found again and again is you know, people not believing that food can be such a great agent of change, and part of that is when we're talking about softer modalities such as food and a lot of the things that we use in integrative medicine, the change comes more slowly, but it comes assuredly. And I think that's the difference than, you know, coming into the hospital and getting very potent and sometimes often very necessary antibiotics, and you see the change right there. There is some faith and consistency that's really necessary in making these dietary changes.
Thank you for your call, Cheryl. Let's take Wanda in Berkeley now. You're on with us, Wanda.
Oh, hi. Hi. I really appreciate your opening to the public, and I just wanted to say something. It would be good if you might question vaccines a little more. I happen to have two personal acquaintances who received the shingles vaccine and got shingles after they got that vaccine. So I do think it would be, you know, that isn't necessarily a cure. Thank you.
Yes. Oh, vaccines. It's a subject I avoid all the time. I'm sorry, Wanda, you're right. I mean, it's a tough subject because we always hear about, you know, side effects. I got the shingles vaccine and I was on the couch for 2 days, not with shingles, but having some kind of reaction to it. I'm glad I got it. I don't want to get shingles.
Sure.
Shingles, I've seen people with shingles. It really is awful. So any quick response to that?
Yeah, I think this is a very complex topic, certainly, that we can't cover today. But I would say that, you know, one of the things I remember being in medical school and when I was doing an infectious disease rotation, my professor was from the Middle East. And when we started talking about this, he just really drove in the point and the understanding that while there can be deleterious effects of vaccines and they're absolutely well documented and they occur, that overall, by and large, I mean, vaccines have been a savior for us and really have allowed us to, you know, decrease the amount of childhood mortality. I think when I was talking specifically about the vaccine for shingles, it really is about decreasing the effects that can come with it. And certainly, shingle isn't something that we have a bunch of mortality. People are not typically dying from this.
They're just suffering. Right.
But it is along the lines of the trifecta of childbirth, kidney stones, and post-herpetic neuralgia. And you talk to people that have experienced that, it's horrendous. And so if a vaccine can decrease the severity of those symptoms potentially, a lot of people will choose to do that. It actually only prevents it, the first episode of shingles, it prevents it by about 60%. So it's not like you get the shingles vaccine, you're not going to have shingles. It's really about tempering those symptoms. Alternatively, you could actually, you know, not do that, and if you are stricken with this, head straight to the acupuncturist and really be proactive about doing more alternative and integrative things.
You know, and I think why I avoid the topic so much is, as a traditional nurse for 50 years, I've seen kids no longer get meningitis because they're getting the HIV, the
epiglottitis.
Right. Mm-hmm. I see kids not getting whooping cough and pertussis, and I also know that there are real issues.
Absolutely.
And I want to, you know, say that that's so valid, and maybe someday I'll have enough courage to do a show on it. I don't know.
It's a very complex topic.
It is. Tim from American Canyon, you're on with us on About Health.
Hi, just as a follow-up to the gluten part of the conversation, and it's my understanding that the reason there's an interest in ancient grains is that the wheat that's being used these days for what you buy at the store, bread products or whatever, is a certain kind of wheat that's been changed over the years, bred to be more resistant to maybe, you know, pesticides or whatever, but it has a huge amount of gluten compared to the wheat that we were all consuming 75 years ago.
Right.
So it might just be worthwhile pointing that out to people that are having a hard time giving up breads, that if they look at organic ancient grains like kamut and spelt and things like that, it might have been much less exposure to gluten that way.
That's a great point. You know, I have this wonderful son-in-law to be, and he's just gotten into making bread. And he's from Peru, and he's using all kinds of ancient grains. He's experimenting. He makes these wonderful loaves, and he ferments them for over 24 hours so that they're also the sourdough-ish. So that's also better for your gut and good for your gut in many ways. Harry, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think some of the more ancient grains, like specifically with the wheat, you mentioned it's kamut, which we're now growing more in, I believe Montana is growing a lot of it. And it certainly has a lower gluten content. And then for a lot of people, it's much better tolerated. It's unclear, you know, a lot of times the kamut is also organically grown. And so you're not having the glyphosate or Roundup exposure. It doesn't have the genetic modification and the problems that are associated with that. I do agree that this this idea that you know, humans cannot tolerate grains is a little crazy, because, I mean, we evolved with them, and this wasn't something that has caused so much trouble and issue until more recently. And I think a lot of that speaks to when we really are increasing the autoimmunity, and we're having more life stressors, more lifestyle stressors, it opens us up more to attack. And I think that's one of the things that's happened with the gluten, along with the modification and along with the pesticides, is just our body is more sensitive than it used to be. And I think that through really good digestive and eating habits, we can really build up that fire, and then we can tolerate these wonderful things like sourdough bread and more of the ancient grains. But the process...
Yeah, I find myself to be kind of borderline. You know, sometimes I'll get a lot of inflammation, and I think back when that happens, okay, what have I been eating the last couple of days?
Yes.
Usually there's a little pasta, a little pizza, like a buildup of things.
Mm-hmm.
But if I really try to stay cognizant, I really rarely get that reaction. So it's interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good point, Tim.
Absolutely. And it speaks to the fact that 1% of the population has celiac disease. That said, I've almost met no friend or patient that has gone on a gluten elimination diet for a month and not felt a little bit better. Sometimes they feel a little bit better, and they're Italian, and they have family dinners every Sunday, and they eat their pasta, and they know that maybe they're going to make sure they take their digestive enzymes beforehand. But I really don't like creating any adversarial relationships with food. And so eating whole organic food is always a great place to start, and I don't think that wheat is necessarily the enemy. But if you have an autoimmune process that's already started, then I think that a trial off it is certainly warranted.
Thank you so much for your call,
Tim. Thanks for your show. It's excellent.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Yes. You know, and Harry, it comes back to this whole idea of experimentation.
Mm-hmm.
But I found that without some guidance, I didn't know what to do. And even now that I've gone off a lot of things, I wonder, you know, do I really need to be off nightshades, for instance? You know, again,
right.
We've talked about this, tomatoes and eggplants and peppers. And I think what you've said and what I'm learning is if we can be mindful of experimenting and trying something back. So the other night I had some wonderful birthday cake because I just couldn't resist it. And I tried to stay very cognizant of what was going on with my body afterwards. And Tim made me think of a question for you is, you know, how do you know there's inflammation? What are some of the signs and symptoms when your body is feeling inflamed?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So absolutely. One of the first things that a lot of us notice is maybe we have some bloating in our abdomen, right? We could have a headache. That's often one of the first signs of any sort of sensitivity to food. And then certainly this whole concept of brain fog and just feeling a little fuzzy, I think, is one of the more predominant symptoms that I hear a lot of people speak about. But usually around that, you're having more loose bowel movements, more gassy, and then just this sense of unease, honestly.
Yeah. So another big one is going off sugar and alcohol, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, all of that. And I think it's important, like you were speaking to, it's really having this awareness and continuing to experiment. I mean, because we will make choices that we know maybe aren't the best things specifically for our gastrointestinal tract, but maybe they're the best thing for our family. And so you can do that, but you can do that with the awareness and knowing that you might need to take some precautions beforehand and suffer some symptoms afterwards.
Right. That does happen. I want to mention Donna Jackson Nakazawa. I did an interview with her, and I just want people to know, this is Nurse Rona, that you can go to my website at nurserona.com and find all my previous shows. I also have a wonderful interview on gut health on my show. But Donna Jackson Nakazawa has written, I think, three or four books, and one of them is The Autoimmune Epidemic. And she had autoimmune disease. She does have autoimmune disease. She has Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is similar to MS, but it has a more sudden onset. And she, in her book, she talks a lot about her healing, and she talks about all the different modalities and all the different things she does. In her most recent book, Childhood Disrupted, she's also talking about the effect of emotional components that impact us at a cellular level, and that scientists now know the impact is real, and that efforts to shift our state of mind from pain and fear to joy and well-being don't merely make us feel better, they induce healing responses in the brain as well. And I have an interview with her on my website. But that's where, again, she talks about things like yoga, psychotherapy, laughter, going out in nature, acupuncture, you know, all kinds of ways in which we can help heal ourselves, not just feel good, but actually heal ourselves. So as we're winding down here, I want to make sure there's not something else you want to talk about when it comes to autoimmune disease. We need some traditional medicines. We often need non-traditional ways of healing, like mm-hmm. acupuncture, which is more traditional now. I don't want to call it non-traditional. Right. What else have we not mentioned, Harry?
Well, I think what you're speaking to, and specifically with this woman's new book, is just this idea that we really need community. I mean, one of the factors that they're seeing with not only people getting certain disease processes, but then also how they do with them is what kind of support they feel like they're getting. There was a recent study, and I can't remember where, but showing as far as like the impact on someone's life, that the sense of community and belongingness, you know, lack of isolation was equivalent to the impact on someone's health was equivalent to the death of a loved one. And so this idea that, you know, we can be out there and going it alone really doesn't work for most of us. And we really need to focus on all of the lifestyle changes, but really reaching out and having conversations and experimenting with food and talking to people about it.
Let's try and squeeze in one more call. We have a caller now from Santa Cruz. Hi, you're on About Health.
Hey there. How are you guys?
Good, good. We have a few minutes left. What would you like to ask?
Great. Thanks so much for taking my call. I'll be real quick. So I had Hashimoto's and Graves' disease very early. I'm 34 now, so I had it when I was about diagnosed when I was about 15.
Oh, wow.
And then I had my thyroid treated with the radioactive iodine treatment, so I'm taking thyroid medicine every day. But most recently, within the last maybe 4 years, I got a alopecia areata, so actually losing portions of my hair on my scalp in patchy areas, which is considered somewhat of an autoimmune disease as well.
Uh-huh.
Wondering if the doctor had any thoughts on that for treatment, or any thoughts almost on any other diseases that may be linked into this kind of family that I should be aware of, or might be a precursor for other problems I could have later on.
Tell me your name again.
Derek.
Derek. Thank you, Derek. And since we only have a few minutes left, we can't go into too much detail. But, Derek, you know, having thyroid and Graves at an early age, did they ever tell you what triggered that? Do you know that?
No, I don't.
Okay. Yeah, because I know there's a genetic component, too,
sure,
with it.
Sure, there can be. I think speaking specifically to the alopecia areata, it is typically seen as an autoimmune process. And there are a lot of ways to support that from an autoimmune process, autoimmune perspective, like we'd spoken about. Certainly everything around restoring gut integrity and making sure that we're managing our lifestyle and stressors appropriately. And then, honestly, one of the things with alopecia areata is sometimes it resolves on its own. And then having your doctor do local steroid injections actually really is effective. And typically after, you know, doing that for a month or two, you'll see new hair growth.
Good. And if you can, you know, see if you can read up on some of the functional medicine approaches to autoimmune disease and thyroid. And we didn't mention exercise, which is also a great way
Absolutely.
To always treat it.
Mm-hmm.
And I wish you so much wellness and goodness there. I think we're out of time now, just about. Thank you. Harry McIlroy, thank you for joining us again. Will you come back?
Absolutely, right.
Okay,
thanks so much for having
me. And I want to thank all of our callers and listeners. I'll be back next week. And if you missed any part of the show, you can hear it at my website at nurserona.com. And if you have ideas for shows, call us. Special thanks to James at San Quentin for some of your suggestions for future shows. Eat well, stay healthy, and let's keep helping each other out as often as we can. Thank you, Michael Yoshida at the controls.
think of the Hard Knock, you think of that.
Station of Resistance.
One of the most phenomenal beats of all time.
Good information and great radio.
News, views, and hip-hop.
What? Do it the way you feel it.
Hard Knock.
Hard Knock.
Hard Knock Radio.
Monday through Friday.
And it's from 4 to 5 p.m. knocking hard in your area.
94.1 KPFA.
Only revolution is our evolution.
So good.
The Haiti Action Committee invites you to welcome Maurice Narcisse to the Bay Area. Dr. Narcisse is a beloved grassroots leader in Haiti and presidential candidate of the Lavalas Family Party of former President Aristide. Sunday, April 23rd, 3 to 5 p.m., First Presbyterian Church of Oakland, 27th and Broadway. Music by the Vukani Mawetu Choir, Favia Kuchichagulia, and Val Sarant. This wheelchair-accessible event is a benefit for the Haiti Emergency Relief Fund, a project of the East Bay Sanctuary Covenant. For more information, call 510-483-7481. That's 510-483-7481.
You're listening to KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley or KFCF 88.1 in Fresno or K248BR in Santa Cruz. Stay tuned for Cover to Cover coming up at 3 o'clock.